everyone. Today we're going to talk about section 3 of the BMAT. You've got 30 minutes to come up with a well thought out argument that argues both for and against a statement, and on top of all that, you've only got one side of A4 to fit it all onto. Keep listening if you want to find out everything you'd want to know about section 3 of the BMAT and my top tips to help you prepare that don't involve having to shrink your handwriting. Hi everyone, my name's Jess from MedicMind and I'm a fourth year medical student at the University of Birmingham. If you want to learn more about the BMAT, UCAT and all that sort of stuff, don't forget to subscribe and hit the round bell so you don't miss anything. And keep listening to find out everything you could want to know about Section 3 of the BMAT. On the BMAT website, they say Section 3 is testing the capacity to develop ideas and communicate them in writing. It is not a test of knowledge. In this section, you're not being tested on how much you know, but instead you're being tested on how well you can formulate an argument, consider both sides of an opinion, and communicate this effectively in your essay. This also means you shouldn't need to use any of the science and maths knowledge you used in Section 2. The format of the question will be 3 questions and you can choose one to write your essay about. These will normally be 3 different statements and beneath will be a series of prompts to help you structure your argument, each one of which you'll need to answer. The statements tend to be quite philosophical. I've got here the question from the BMAT specification paper and this one says, "Our belief in any particular natural law cannot have a safer basis than our unsuccessful critical attempts to refute it." And this is in quotes, and underneath it says it's by Karl Popper. And the questions underneath to help you structure your argument are to explain what this statement means, argue to the contrary that science may not proceed by attempting to refute hypotheses, and to what extent do you think this statement accurately reflects the nature of scientific method? I'd probably say that's one of the most difficult questions in the sample paper, but if you think about it for a bit, there are probably some things you can come up with to say. And keep in mind, you only need to fill one side of A4, so you have to be pretty concise anyway. So the first prompt is asking you to explain the statement. It's basically saying that good scientific laws need to have a way to prove them wrong. And if you can't prove a scientific law wrong, you probably have a good theory. Karl Popper, who made this statement, was a philosopher, and one of his main concerns was the way that we define science and what sets out science from other types of trying to acquire knowledge. And the concept itself is called falsifiability. The next prompt is asking you to argue to the contrary. They want you to argue the opposite of what they've said. So for this part, you're wanting to argue that science can move forward without having to prove hypotheses wrong. For this, you might want to start thinking about theories that maybe can't be proved wrong, or the way in which we try and prove theories wrong. For the second part of this, you might want to think about the fact that our ability to prove theories wrong depends on how good our technology is at the time. So at the moment, we might not have the technology to prove certain theories that we think are right wrong, but later in the future, we might realise that they weren't in fact correct. But despite that, these theories are still contributing to our scientific knowledge and helping us progress. If you're doing something like physics A-level, this might make you think of something like Newtonian mechanics, which explains the way that objects gain and lose speed, and things like the relationship between force, mass, and acceleration. You might have remembered that equation from GCSE as well. This theory was taken to be correct for a long time, and it was only when we had the technology to study both very small particles and also the changes in time and gravity that we see in space that we're able to start to prove parts of this theory wrong. And this then meant that the newer theories of relativity could be developed. However, Newton's theories, although eventually proved wrong, contributed massively to progressing science at the time and helping us understand the way that objects move. Furthermore, if we had proved theories wrong, like Newtonian mechanics at the time, we might have missed the important contributions that they would have made, particularly when you consider things like mechanics, where Newtonian equations are still used. And then to answer the last prompt, all of what we've said above shows that although falsifiability can be important for some scientific theories, it can't be applicable to all of them. If you think of things like theories of physics, such as supersymmetry or string theory, these are so abstract that they're very difficult to prove wrong, but they've still helped progress our understanding of how particles move and interact with each other. Like I said, that's probably one of the most difficult questions on the sample paper, in my opinion. So if you think you'd struggle with coming up with things to write like that, you should probably choose one of the other 2 questions. If you've got any other arguments that you could have made for that question, let me know in the comments below. Usually the three statements will be one on healthcare, one on something more generally science-based, and one that's a bit more broad, so about like human nature or philosophy or ethics. It might be really tempting to go straight for the healthcare one, but take a good read of all three prompts and decide which one you've got more examples for. Normally the ones that are a bit more broad, you might have a bit more to say about. We'll talk a bit about how this section is marked, and then we'll move on to my top tips to ace this section. So in this section, your essay will be marked by two independent markers, and each one of them will give you a score for your content from 0 to 5. This score will depend on your use of logic, how well you used examples to support your case, and whether you answered all three of the prompts that they gave you. You'll then get a mark of either A, C, or E, depending on your quality of written English. The two marks are then averaged to give you your final score. In 2019, the most common score was a 3, and 70% of people got an A for their English language. Only about 5% of candidates are expected to score a 4 or more. It's also worth noting that different universities will use your Section 3 in different ways. For example, at Brighton and Sussex Medical School, they'll give you an overall BMAT score, to which Section 3 will contribute the most. Whereas at Oxford, they'll weight your BMAT and your GCSE scores 50-50. And for your BMAT score, only 20% of that will be made up of your Section 3. It's also worth noting that you should most definitely write down which question you answered for your Section 3 and get a rough idea of what you actually wrote, as some universities have been known to pull out your essay and ask you to explain why you wrote what you did. So, how do you prepare? I'd say the best way to prepare for this section is to practice as much as possible. This is not only to get an idea of the types of questions that come up, but also to practice writing an essay in only 30 minutes and fitting all of this onto one side of paper. Practice making essay plans and then writing these out onto one of the specimen answer sheets. This will give you a better understanding of both how much space and how much time you have, because for both it isn't much. Most importantly, make sure someone checks your essay. You could have written something that makes perfect sense to you, but absolute gibberish to anyone else. If you're looking for someone more experienced to read your essay, who can give you a rough idea of what kind of mark you'd get if you submitted it in the real thing, take a look at the MedicMind website, where our BMAT tutors can do all of this for you. As you probably saw in the practice question, some of the statements rely on relatively well-known ethical and philosophical theories, and you'll get more marks if you can correctly identify these and incorporate this into your answer. Taking a flick through books or even websites that explain common ethical theories definitely won't hurt, and if you ever read books such as Sophie's World, now is definitely the time to revisit it. However, don't get too stressed trying to memorize what every single theory is. You can probably come to similar conclusions just by thinking through the prompt yourself. And on top of that, having a well thought out answer that considers both sides of the statement and comes to a proper conclusion will get you far more marks than just being able to name the theory and do nothing else. So let's get on to the tips. Tip number one is to pick the right question for you. If you had no idea what I was talking about earlier, that should not be the question you choose to answer in the exam. Remember that you need to be able to answer all three of the prompts underneath the question. There's no use picking a question where you only think you'll be able to answer two really well, or maybe even one and just have nothing to say for the other two. If you don't answer all three of the prompts equally, the highest mark you can get is a 2, and that doesn't matter how well written your answer is. Tip number 2 is plan. You'll have space on the question sheet to write down some notes, and I would use at least 5 minutes to write a thorough plan of what you're going to write. Dedicate a paragraph for each of the three prompts and write some bullet points under each of what you're going to say. Some people even recommend to spend as many as 15 minutes planning, as once you've got a good plan, you shouldn't have to think about what you're going to write. Also, if you're really worried about not having enough space, it might be useful to make markings to divide the answer sheet into 3, so you know exactly when you should be starting to move on to your next point. Tip number 3 is practice to time. The amount of time you'll need to plan, write, and even just sit there and kind of understand what the question's asking you will vary for everyone. Make sure you know how much time you'll need on the day by practicing to time and doing it often. You can even try doing an entire BMAT paper to give you an idea of how you feel after trying to concentrate for 1.5 hours and still have an essay to go. Tip 4 is to use your examples wisely. Examples are a great way to try and get your point of view across, but you don't want to be wasting time setting up these elaborate examples only for them to prove a tiny point. Some examples require more time and some require less time, and you shouldn't be afraid to do that. Tip 5 is to make sure you reach a conclusion. you should consider both sides of the argument, and you might decide you agree slightly more with one than the other, or you agree with one but only in certain circumstances. All of this should be set out in your conclusion. This is what will get you a 5, which it says requires a compelling synthesis or conclusion in the mark scheme. My final tip is don't panic. Section 3 of the BMAT carries the least weight in the exam, although it can feel like the most difficult part. It's not something you should be losing sleep over or trying to learn every single philosophical theory for. The best thing you can do is practice working to time, as this is what will catch a lot of people out. You should also practice making succinct arguments that have no waffle in them, and with that, that should be more than enough for you to get a good score in this section. If you want to learn more ways to improve your BMAT, UCAT, personal statement, and all that sort of stuff, don't forget to subscribe and hit the round bell so you don't miss anything. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and share it with someone you know who might be taking the BMAT. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.